Good morning, my name is Alice Gatti and I am a postdoc in the Scalable Solvers group. And today I'm going to talk about a deep reinforcement learning model for the graph partitioning problem. And the reason why we're interested in this problem is because it is strictly related with sparse matrix computations, where a sparse matrix is a matrix which is mostly filled with zeros. And sparse matrices appear in a wide range of real-world applications like simulations, optimization problems, fluid dynamic problems, PD discretizations, and many others. For example, if we want to solve this partial differential equation here with these boundary conditions on this discretized domain, D square, then with the finite element method, it is possible to associate to this system a sparse matrix of this form. And thanks to this matrix, it is possible to find the solution of the system. And so this is just an example of how sparse matrices appear in PDE discretizations. And sparse matrices coming from real-world applications often have a huge dimension, and so it's very important that the computations on them are extremely optimized. In particular, there is the necessity of running the computations in parallel. And if we restrict to the class of sparse symmetric matrices, then it is possible to associate to each one of them an undirected graph. Indeed, a sparse symmetric matrix can be considered as the adiacency matrix of an undirected graph. And if you want to parallelize efficiently the computations on these matrices, what we want to do is to reorder the rows and the columns of this matrix such that the resulting matrix is as close as possible to a block diagonal matrix. And performing this operation correspond to perform certain operations on the corresponding graph that are called graph partitioning. For example, if we consider this sparse matrix here, then the rows and the columns correspond to the vertices of the corresponding graph here on the left. And the entries of the matrix correspond to the edges of this graph. And if we assign a color to the rows and the columns of this matrix, let's say red for rows that go from 0 to 70 and blue for the others, then also the vertices of the graph inherit these colors. And we can see that there is a lot of connections between red and blue vertices. But if we reorder the rows and the columns of the matrix in a smart way, we see that we can write the matrix in this form, in this block diagonal form. So we have the two blocks here on the diagonal and a small number of off-diagonal entries. And we can see that also the corresponding graph is partitioned in some sense into two subsets. So the entries inside the two blocks corresponds to the edges inside the two subsets, subsets of vertices of the graph, while the off-diagonal entries correspond to the edges between red and blue vertices. So our goal, in order to parallelize efficiently, is to reorder the rows and the columns of a sparse matrix such that the matrix is in this form, so in this block diagonal form, where the number of off-diagonal entries is minimized, but also the two blocks have approximately the same size. And from the point of view of the graph, this means to reorder the vertices such that we can divide the vertices of the graph into two subsets with the connection between them minimized, and also such that these two subsets have approximately the same size. And there are existing heuristics that do this task, but they don't scale well with the number of processors or with the number of nodes. And so our idea was to improve them by using some machine learning techniques. First of all, I would like to give some background definitions. So an undirected graph is constituted by a set of vertices and a set of non-oriented edges. And one can think of a graph as this figure here with some dots connected by some edges. And often we call the vertices also nodes. And for a vertex, its degree is defined as the number of edges that are connected to it, and for a subset of vertices, its volume is defined as the sum of the degrees of these vertices. And if we have a partition of the set of vertices of the graph, we can define its cut as the number of edges that connect the two partitions. In the example that we have seen before, this is exactly the number of edges between red and blue vertices. And notice that this definition doesn't take into account the size of the two partitions. It just considers the number of edges that connect the two partitions. But actually, we are interested also in the fact that the two partitions have the same size. And so we have to consider a finer definition of cut, which is called the normalized cut. The technical definition is not important, but what is important is to remember that it takes into account both the cut of the partition, but also the two volumes of the two subsets. And so this is why we're interested in this definition. And so our goal is, given a graph, we want to find a partition of its set of vertices which minimizes the normalized cut. I would like to illustrate the difference between minimum cut and the minimum normalized cut, and so why we choose to minimize the normalized cut. So in this graph here, we see that these two partitions, red and blue, this partition minimizes the cut because it's just one, but the two partitions are very unbalanced because almost all the vertices are in the red partition. While in the partition here, on the right, we see that the cut is still one here, but the two partitions are more balanced. Indeed, they have almost the same volume and the same cardinality. And in particular, this partition realizes the minimum normalized cut. And so this is why we are interested in this finer definition of cut. And the minimum normalized cut problem is known to be an NP-complete problem, so there's not the possibility of solving it in polynomial time. And it belongs to the class of problems like the traveling Salesman problem or the graph coloring problem and many others. As I said before, there are existing heuristics that are able to find approximate solutions to this problem, like the Kerning-Allin or the Fiducia-Matteises algorithms or some spectral techniques. But for example, the first two, the Kerning-Allin and the Fiducia-Matteises, have an irregular memory access because of how they are designed, while spectral techniques are very expensive, especially for large graphs. And so our idea was to tackle this problem with deep reinforcement learning. In general, reinforcement learning is a very well-studied framework that models an agent that interacts with an environment. In particular, the agent is in some instances of the environment called states. It takes actions in these states, and the environment returns a reward in another state, where the reward is just a number that says if the taken action was good or bad. So the agent now is in another state, and it takes again an action, and so on. So there is this loop that goes back and forth between the agent and the environment. And the goal of the agent is to take actions such that the cumulative reward that it receives is maximized. For example, if we consider a robot that has to learn to escape from a maze in the smallest amount of time. In this case, the agent is the robot, the environment is the maze, the states of the environment are the positions inside the maze and also with the surroundings. The actions go north, west, east and south, and the reward is always minus one until the agent stays inside the maze and zero when it's able to escape from the maze. And so, since it has to maximize the cumulative reward, it has to collect the minimum number of minus one. And so it will learn to escape from the maze in the smallest number of steps. And in general, the probabilities for which the agent takes actions are not known, and of course that needs to be estimated. And a common way of estimating the probabilities is by using a deep neural network. And in this case, reinforcement learning takes the name of deep reinforcement learning. And this is also what we are going to do. So for us, the agent will be a deep neural network. This deep neural network will output the probabilities and some probabilities, and the actions will be taken with respect to these probabilities. More precisely, in our context, the setup is the following. So the environment for us is a graph. The states are the partitions of this graph. The actions are moving one node from one partition to the other, and the reward is the difference of the normalized cut before and after moving the node. And the deep reinforcement learning agent that we use is called Asynchronous Actor Critic. And by an agent, I simply mean a deep neural network with a particular loss function that has to be minimized in order to find the optimal parameters of the deep neural network. And the training goes as follows. So we start from a graph, a partition with all nodes in one partition, except for one node with minimum degree. So as in this case here. So we have all the nodes in the red partition, except for this blue one that has minimum degree, because it's just one, in the opposite partition. And at each step of the deep reinforcement learning loop, the agent, so the deep neural network, will output the probabilities, a probability for each node, and we select a node according to these probabilities, and we add this node to the blue partition. And we continue with this loop until the two partitions have the same cardinality. And this is a good condition to stop because it's related to the fact that the two partitions have the same volume, so to the partition that we have showed at the beginning. And since the reward is the difference of the two normalized cut before and after moving the node, the agent will learn to choose the nodes such that minimizes at each step the normalized cut. I don't have the time of going into the details of this deep reinforcement learning agent, but I would like to point out a couple of key ingredients in its construction. First of all, the type of layers that we use inside the deep neural network. These are graph convolutional layers, and that also includes a self-attention mechanism, and are called graph attention layers. So they are very powerful because they combine graph convolution, which generalizes the usual convolution on grids, and it's very important, and also the self-attention mechanism. More precisely, each node of the graph has some features, which is just a vector associated to each node. And for example, if we want to apply this graph attention layer to the features of this node 1, then what this layer does is consider the features of its neighbors, so the features of 2, 3, 4, and 5. Then it takes a weighted sum of these features with certain coefficients, and then it applies a matrix of weights to this sum. And the important thing is that both the weight of the matrix and the weights of the weighted sum are learnable, and in particular these coefficients alpha are called attention coefficients. In our case, each node has two features, 1, 0 or 0, 1, according to which partition it belongs. And these graph attention layers are very important because they capture local properties of the graph, but they are not enough, especially for large graphs, because we also want to take into account global properties of the graph. And so our idea was to introduce another tool that is able to capture these features. And in particular, this is a deep neural network module that sits inside the deep neural network that models the agent. And more precisely, what this module does is the following thing. It takes as input a graph, then it applies convolution on its features, then we coarsen the graph, we apply convolution again, we coarsen, convolution, and so on, until the graph is small enough. After we have reached this small graph, we apply a fully connected neural network to the features, and we revert the process. So we start refining, applying convolution, refining, convolution, and so on, until the graph is the same as the initial one. The things that change are the features of the nodes. And also we have this residual connection here between the coarsening and the refining process that allows to preserve the information coming from the coarsening process. And this figure here on the bottom explains what is going on inside this deep neural network module. And it's like it is capturing different properties at different zoom levels. So we start with The initial graph, which is fine at many nodes and edges. Then we reduce a little bit the zoom, and we have this graph here, and we apply convolution to the features of this graph. Then we reduce again the zoom, and so on, until we reach a very small graph with just a bunch of nodes and edges. And then we revert the process, and we start to increase the zoom, and so on, until we reach again the final graph. Okay, so these were the two main ingredients of our deep reinforcement learning agent. And finally, we can show some results, and we compared our deep reinforcement learning agent with Mitis, which is a popular software for graph partitioning, and in particular we tested our agent on two classes of graphs. The first one is constituted by the Lune meshes, and the second one by 2D-3D discretizations. And the Lune meshes for us are certain triangulations on random points on the unit square, while the graphs in the 2D-3D discretization class are taken from the Swift Sparse Matrix collection, which is a collection of sparse matrices coming from a wide range of real-world applications. And in both classes, the graphs has at most 1,000 nodes. And so, for example, for the Lune meshes, on the top we have the results for training, on the bottom for testing, and in the right histogram we have the relative balance, in the left one the relative cut, and the blue columns are the results for deep reinforcement learning, and the orange one are the results for Mitis. And also we show the results for different types, different number of vertices of the graphs. And so we see that both for training and testing, the balance is the same as the one of Mitis. And also the cut is very similar. It seems that there is a small difference, but one has to look also at the scale of the relative cut. And so they are very close to each other. And the same is for the testing dataset. The results, the relative cut are very, very close. And notice that we include in the testing dataset also some graphs that have a larger number of nodes with respect to the graph that have been used for the training. And so we can see that also for this kind of graphs, the results are very close to the one of Mitis. While for 2D-3D discretizations, the training was very hard on these graphs because in this class there is a huge varieties of graphs and discretizations, and but also in this case we see that the balance of the deep reinforcement learning agent and Mitis are the same, and also the cuts are very close to each other. As before, it seems that there is a small difference, but one has to look also at the scale of the graph of the cut. And and so this shows some results for deep reinforcement learning agent. And so to sum up, we have introduced a deep reinforcement learning model for the graph partitioning problem, in which the agent includes a deep neural network module that is able to capture global properties of the graph. And there is still room for improvement. The model now is slow, and so we would like to improve the runtimes, for example, by using a multi-level approach that cut and refine with deep reinforcement learning in intermediate steps. For example, if we start from this graph here, then we can coarsen it, and then we can apply deep reinforcement learning to partition it. Then we can refine the graph and apply again deep reinforcement learning to refine the cut and the partitions, and so on, until we reach the finest graph. And we can also apply deep reinforcement learning at the end to refine the partition. And another important thing is to test on larger graphs and different types of meshes and graphs. And with this I conclude, and thank you very much for your attention.